Hello everybody, this is lesson 17 of the lecture Macroeconomics. I will discuss the slides 34 to 71 of chapter 4, the Keynesian model. In this lesson, we will develop a graphical tool called Keynesian Cross. An important result of our last lesson was Keynes' theorem. According to Keynes' theorem, the demand for goods determines the supply of goods. The explanation is, since firms keep their prices constant in the short run, they adjust instead their production quantities of goods to the demand for goods. So GDP supply equals always consumption demand of households plus investment goods demand by firms plus government consumption demand by the government. If we introduce now the Keynesian consumption function into this equation, we receive the following relationship. This is obviously a circular relationship. GDP depends on consumption, while consumption depends on GDP, and so on. In the following section, we will first solve the circular relationship mathematically and then develop a graphical tool to solve the relationship graphically. As it will turn out, the Keynesian cross is in fact this graphical tool that helps to solve this circular relationship graphically. Let's start again with Keynes' theorem. GDP equals always the total demand for goods. The total demand for goods equals consumption demand plus investment goods demand plus government consumption demand. For simplicity, we will assume that investment goods demand and government consumption demand are constant. As we will later see, investment goods demand depends on the interest rate determined on the capital market, while government consumption demand is exogenously determined by the government. What exactly means now this consumption function C depending on household income, which equals GDP? Let's make a numerical example. Let's assume that the consumption ratio, the part of income that is consumed, equals 50% and that income or GDP equals 100 units. So this general expression for the consumption function can then be substituted by a concrete function C, the consumption ratio, times household income. If we now fill in the numbers, we find that the value of consumption in this case equals 50. 50% times 100. So this is the way how we can interpret this consumption function. We can now solve the circular relationship if we fill in the concrete form for the consumption function. In this way, we substitute consumption function by the consumption ratio times GDP. Now we can subtract the consumption function from both sides of the equation. So consumption function disappears on the right side and reappears on the left side with a negative sign. Now we can place GDP outside the brackets and then divide both sides of the equation over this bracket which is 1 minus the consumption ratio. You observe now that the level of GDP can be calculated by multiplying the investment level times this multiplier, 1 over 1 minus the consumption ratio, plus the government consumption level times the same multiplier. The multiplier is called the Keynesian multiplier. This result means that GDP depends now completely on the size of the consumption ratio, the level of investment by firms, and the level of government consumption. To make a numerical example, let's assume that the consumption ratio is 50%, investment level is 5 units GDP, government consumption is also 5 units GDP, and now we can fill in these values in this equation, which is reproduced here. So we fill in 5 for investment, 5 for government consumption, and then we fill in for the consumption ratio 50%. You observe that the Keynesian multiplier receives then a value of 2. 1 minus 50% is 50%, 1 over 50% is 2. So we have to multiply 2 with the investment level and the government consumption level, which equals 10. 10 plus 10 is 20. So if you have these values, as in this numerical example, for investment, government consumption, and the consumption ratio, GDP will equal 20 units. Let's now transfer this mathematical solution to a diagram. As it will turn out, this diagram is now, in fact, the Keynesian cross. First, we represent the Keynesian consumption function graphically. We measure household income, or GDP, on the x-axis, and the demand for goods on the y-axis. The Keynesian consumption function is now a straight line which starts in the zero point of the diagram, like this. The slope of this line is equal to the consumption ratio, 50%, 0.5. This means that, for example, at an income level of 10, consumption equals 50% times 10, 5. While at an income level of, let's say, 30, consumption equals 30 times 50%, 15. So it is, in fact, the consumption ratio that determines the slope of the consumption function. If the consumption ratio is smaller than 50%, this line would move downward, and if consumption ratio would be higher than 50%, the consumption function line would shift upward. Turning point in all cases is zero, since if GDP is zero, consumption is always zero. In a closed economy, without income taxes, household income equals always GDP. So instead of income, we can talk in the following of GDP. The consumption function informs about the consumption level depending on the level of GDP. If total demand equals consumption demand plus government expenditure of, let's assume, 5 units GDP, we have to add government consumption vertically to the consumption function. So the total demand for goods is 5 units higher than the consumption function. If you have additionally 5 units of investment goods demand by private firms, we have to add these 5 units additionally to receive the total demand function. So now we have a total demand function that consists of 3 components: consumption demand from households plus government consumption demand plus investment goods demand. The big question is now, how do we find the equilibrium level of demand for goods given this Keynesian total demand function? In other words, at what level of income does total demand for goods equal income? As we will see, there is only one GDP level where this equation holds exactly. We have already derived the solution for the numerical values we have used in this diagram mathematically. So we found already that the equilibrium GDP level equals 20 units of GDP. So we are now in the comfortable position to check whether this mathematical solution works also graphically. If we start with an income level of 20 units GDP here, we find indeed that total demand finally equals also 20. So demand for goods equals supply of goods only at a GDP level of 20 units. At this GDP level, we have 10 units consumption demand plus 5 units government consumption demand plus 5 units investment goods demand. This adds up to 5 plus 5 plus 10, 20 units total demand, which is again equal to the GDP level. So this works if we calculate the solution to this problem mathematically. It works also graphically. Question is now, how can we find this equilibrium level of GDP without mathematical calculations? In fact, the solution to this problem is quite simple. Since in an equilibrium, by definition, demand and supply of goods must be equal, all market equilibrium points must lie on the 45-degree line. The 45-degree line contains all points where demand for goods equals supply. The 45-degree line is the bisectrix of the diagram. For example, if we start with a GDP supply of 10 and draw a vertical line to the 45-degree line, we find that the 45-degree line reflects a value of 10 also on the demand axis of the diagram. Or if we start with a GDP level of 25 and draw again a vertical line to the 45-degree line, we find that the 45-degree line reflects a value of 25 also on the demand axis of the diagram. Or let's take the value of 20, which we have already used. We draw a vertical line to the 45-degree line. 45-degree line reflects a value of 20 also on the demand axis of the diagram. In other words, only points on the 45-degree line are points where demand for goods equals supply of goods. So if we add now the 45 degree line to the demand for goods function, we can observe that the intersection point represents indeed the solution we have already found, 20. So if we use the 45 degree line as a graphical tool, we can immediately determine the market equilibrium on the market for goods without doing any laborious mathematical calculations. We simply have to search for the intersection point between the total demand function with the 45 degree line. The following digression shows that the equilibrium on the Keynesian market for goods is also dynamically stable. This means if we start with a disequilibrium like excess demand or excess supply on the market for goods, an adjustment process will take place, which finally leads to the market equilibrium point. You can check the slides yourself, they are self-explanatory. We will in the following take it for granted that the market equilibrium is always dynamically stable. So much for this lesson. In the next lesson, we will analyze what happens if the market equilibrium is disturbed by a sudden increase in the investment demand.